So here's what we know about Nicodemus. He was a wealthy and well-educated man. He was well-respected among the Jews, and he was a descendant of Abraham. He was a religious man because he was a Pharisee. Now, the Pharisees were the chief teachers and educators of the Jewish people. All right? Because you'll see when Jesus spoke to him later on, he said, you're a teacher of the people and you don't know this, but the Pharisees were the ones that had the education. They studied the Old Testament books. They were the ones that were the teachers and the religious leaders of the day. Amen? But there was some strange thing about the Pharisees, because the word Pharisee means separated one. All right? And the Pharisees had some strange ways, because the Pharisees were the traditionalists of the day. The Pharisees wanted to do everything the way they had been doing it all the time. They believed in tradition. They believed in the religious rites. In other words, we're going to be doing this the same way they did it for centuries and centuries and centuries, because that's the book of the law. They believed in the book of the law, and that you could not part from it at all. They believed in that, and that is what they did all of the time. And so, but he was looked upon. He had great stature in the Jewish community. In fact, he was the kind of guy that, like, you look up, oh man, there goes Nicodemus. He was the kind of person that you wanted to be if you were a Jew, because he had wealth, he had stature, he had respect, he had education, he had everything, and he was a member of the Sanhedrin. So the Sanhedrin is basically like our Supreme Court. It was a group of 72 chiefs, 72 teachers and scribes, leaders that came together, and they established all the rules for the Jewish people. So to be a part of the Sanhedrin means you had a lot of clout. So you see how awesome, I mean, this Nicodemus, in their world, Nicodemus had it going on. Nicodemus was the man, a Pharisee. But as we get to verse 2, we find that Nicodemus comes to visit Jesus at night. We can't go over this, because it was dangerous for a Pharisee to go and visit Jesus, because the Pharisees did not like Jesus. In fact, they wanted to disrespect, disavow, and destroy Jesus. You will see in the New Testament, there are always conflicts between Jesus and the Pharisees, because Jesus was a rebel who wanted to do things differently, and the Pharisees always wanted to do it their way. And so there was always a clash, and yet it says in the Bible that he came to visit him at night. He had to come at night, because if he would have been seen visiting Jesus during the day, it would have been a dangerous situation. And then it gets even greater than that. It says that he came at night to speak with Jesus, and he called him Rabbi. And so please understand that calling Jesus a rabbi was a title of dignity, honor, and respect for distinguished teachers. There were few, if any, Pharisees that would call Jesus rabbi, because they did not respect him. They did not respect what he was teaching. They did not respect his look at the Old Testament. And so to call him a rabbi said something about Nicodemus. And then he says, we all know that you are a teacher who has been sent by God. Number one, he said we, which meant that there were more than just him who he was representing here. He could have said, I know this, but he said we, which means that there had to be some kind of conversation going on among the Pharisees and those people who he hung out with about all that Jesus was doing. So understand now, Jesus is in Jerusalem. He is there for the Passover. He had been in the temple where he had been preaching. He had been performing miracles in the streets of Jerusalem. All of these that Nicodemus had seen. And so Nicodemus knew there was something different about this Jesus. It's interesting to me that he could see this and the other Pharisees couldn't. Because you have to understand that the Pharisees studied the books of the Old Testament, the books of the prophets. They studied those, so they knew the book of Isaiah. And if you know the book of Isaiah, he made the connection between what was going on within Isaiah and what Jesus had been doing. In Isaiah 35:5, it says this. It says this about the coming Messiah. He said, then will the eyes of the blind be opened, the ears of the deaf be unstopped. Then will the lame leap like a deer, and the mute tongue shout for joy. These were all the miracles that Jesus had performed. And Nicodemus had heard about them or seen them, and he knew, well, there's something about this Jesus that makes a connection to this Messiah. And then he knew Isaiah 61:1, it says, the Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me, the Messiah, to preach the good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom of the captives, and to release those from darkness from prison. All of these were the things that Jesus had done. All of these things were the things that Nicodemus had seen and heard of that Jesus had done. And so he came that night to visit Jesus. Then it gets real interesting as Nicodemus tells him, I know you were a teacher sent from God. I know that your miracles have been revealed, that only God can do that. And then Jesus replied. And he says, I tell you the truth. Unless you are born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. Now this is real interesting. Because there was nothing that Nicodemus said that would cause the answer that Jesus gave him. So Jesus answered a question that Nicodemus hadn't even asked. Now, can you see that? Nicodemus was lavishing great words on Jesus. You are he who was sent from God. You are he whose miracles say you are from God. He said, unless you are born again, you can never enter the kingdom of God. So here's what we need to know about Jesus. Amen. No matter what words come out of your mouth, Jesus knows what's in your heart. So for some, this is going to be an excuse. I don't know how to pray. It don't make no difference. See, the key thing is that we do like Nicodemus, is that we go and seek Jesus out. You know, I don't know the words. Don't you worry about it. He knows. What's the song? Jesus knows all about our struggles. You don't have to have the exact. I don't want to pray because I don't have the exact words. Don't worry about the exact words. You just get to Jesus. If you can get to Jesus, things will change. If you will get to Jesus, the deep-seated things that are on the inside that have been messing you up, that have been killing you, that have been just rolling in your spirit, Jesus knows all about it. But you have to do like Nicodemus. We have to make sure that we go and see Jesus. Must be born again. And Nicodemus was like, what are you talking about? How can this be? How can an old man be born again? How can this happen? I often wonder, you know, what was the motivation for Nicodemus? Why did he decide that he had to go and see Jesus? I believe that there was something that he heard about this kingdom of God and this Messiah. You see, that's why I believe this story is given to us during the Lenten season, because Nicodemus had to do some introspection. He had to look at himself, because watch this. Nicodemus had a good life. Nicodemus was the man. He was wealthy and he was educated. Nicodemus was on the Sanhedrin. He was a Pharisee. See, he was looked up to everybody. Nicodemus had a comfortable life, and yet there was something on the inside that let him know that even in all of your comfort, you are not who God called you to be. I got to talk to somebody this morning. You see, because some people believe that I'm doing all right. I don't need to get deeper into Jesus. And some people are comfortable in being exactly who they are and exactly where they are. But I need for you to understand, you need to be like Nicodemus and go find Jesus. Because there's something on the inside that is preventing you from being who God wants you to be, who God created you to be. Yeah, you're doing fine. And so many people just get in their lounge chair and just recline and go, I've got enough Jesus for me. But you see, the amount that you have is only the tip of the iceberg of what Jesus wants to give you. Because Jesus has a great plan for your life. Jesus has more for you, and he is telling you, no matter how comfortable you are, no matter how, what kind of status you have, no matter what nice government job you have, state job you have, no matter how well you're doing, no matter how pretty your car, your house, your closet, it just doesn't even matter to Jesus. Jesus just said, I'm looking at your heart. I'm looking deep on the inside. Look at here, Jesus is saying this, I created you. I know why I created you. I know the gifts that I gave you. I know what you're supposed to be doing. I know. I know this.
Yes.
I know this. And so I'm not going to let you settle for just being just enough for Jesus. Yeah, 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 yeah. He's saying this. You need to come to Jesus because you need to be born again. Nicodemus was like, whoa, wait a minute, I go to the temple every week. I'm a Pharisee, so you know I tithe. I tithe every single week. I do all that is right. I sing in the Jerusalem voices. I sing in the choir. I've even been at the door. I've been a Jerusalem usher. I do everything right. But Jesus told him, I know all that you've done right, but you must be born again. You see, there's something new. There's something I've got to give you. I know you see, the problem is you've been looking through these eyes too long, and I need to give you some Holy Ghost eyes so you can see what it is the Spirit would have for you. You must be born again.
Yes, man.
Now see, I know there's some people within the sound of my voice, and I've already lost you because you're saying, I'm good. I'm good. I serve on all the committees. I sing in the choir. I give a little money to the church. I'm good. You don't have to worry about me. I know this message isn't for me, so I'm gonna read the bulletin. I'm gonna get out of my phone. I'm gonna go somewhere because this isn't about me. But I came by to let you know that this is for you. You see, we need to do like Nicodemus and dig deep and recognize that there's something more that we can do for Christ. Amen? You see, there's people I need for you to understand. Just let me put it this way. Now, Nicodemus went to go and see Jesus. And then Jesus told him something that he never imagined he would hear. Let's say Jesus dropped by your house. And he decided to do an evaluation of how you are as a disciple. So the question is, if Jesus was going to write a list, not based on what you said, because see, Jesus would let you talk. Tell me about your discipleship. Oh boy. We all want. Well, Jesus, I do this. I make soup. I like food for Jesus. Jesus. I cook fried chicken for the pastor. Jesus. Jesus, I do this. I do that. And I do this. I do that. And then Jesus would just be sitting there looking at you. Because Jesus would begin to write the list of the things on your heart. So if Jesus came by your house and did a one-on-one evaluation with you, I'm going to let that marinate. Would he have a short list or a long list? Got quiet. See, now I know there's people, Pastor, I know I don't do everything right. But I do so much right. That might not matter. Well, let's take this down to a little surgical precision so that you can understand what if Jesus came. You see, we need a rebirth in so many areas of our life. I need to be born anew in my forgiveness, Lord. I need to be born anew in my anger, born anew in my relationships, born anew in my fears and doubts. I'm going to come by your street when I do, just say, hey. I need to be born anew in my giving, born anew in my prayer life, born anew in my Bible study, born anew in my relationships within my family, born anew in my new faith, born anew. Ain't nobody said nothing. I didn't hit your street yet. See, Lord God, I know that if you came by, I couldn't say a thing, Lord God. All I can say is I must be born again. I need your help, Jesus. You see, because if you are bad in one area, sin is sin to God, you need to be born. You need to be cleansed completely. You need to be made new. You need to be revived, regenerated, and turned around so that you can be who God wants you to be. You must be born again. We can't contend with God. You can't fool Jesus. I know a lot of you can talk about, that's my thing. I can talk a whole lot of trash. If Jesus walked in, I would just say, mum be the word. I would not. Because I know that there's things that God has told me to do that I have not done. There are people I'm supposed to forgive that I have not forgiven. There are people I'm still talking about. Help me, Lord. In the name of Jesus, and I'm supposed to be, instead of talking about him, I'm supposed to be praying for him. Lord God, help me to be new. Help me, Lord God, to do things differently. I need to be a new creature. And so I need to look on the inside. That's what this Lenten time is all about. I need to look on the inside, Lord God, and really admit that I'm not as good as I would like to think I am. I need to look on the inside in the name of Jesus and say, yes, Lord, I need some course correction. Yes, Lord, I need some help. I can't fake the funk anymore in the name of Jesus. Lord God, I'm tired of being comfortable in this life. I'm tired, Lord, of doing just enough to make me feel good about who I am in you. But Lord God, if you care about me in the name of Jesus, I know I would have to repent. I know I would have to say, Lord God, I must be born again. change God wants to make in your life. Because God is saying, got something. I didn't take you through all I took you through for you to sit on your hands and do nothing. I didn't bless you over and over again. I didn't heal you over and over again. I didn't bring peace in the midst of your badness over and over again so you could sit and not tell nobody. I blessed you so you could be a blessing. In the name of Jesus. Church, I want you to know y'all didn't build this beautiful facility just so we could sit here and admire the work. This was good so we could come in here and learn something about Jesus and go out and make disciples of Jesus Christ. So this is my challenge for you. Do the Nicodemus this week. Go before Jesus at night. You don't have to worry about somebody following you. You don't have to creep. But go in a solitary place, in a solitary time, and say, I need the Lord, I need him. Every hour I need him.
Mess with you. Yeah.
so that you don't get to them. And you can't see them because you're looking through the old eyes of all the stuff you've been able to accumulate. He's been waiting, church. He's been waiting to tell you that despite all of the stature and all of the education and all of the stuff, if you want to be who he created you to be in the kingdom of God, you must be born again. You must come to the Lord and thank him. Lord God, I thank you. Oh Lord God, you've been so good to me. But I heard a word of revelation that lets me know you're not done with me yet. And it has nothing to do with your age, because if he woke you up this morning, so many things God's saying that he wants to do with us and through us. But we have to shake off the comfort clothes. We've got to be hungry again. We've got to be sorry that we have not done what God has called us to do. That's what we have to repent and say, Lord God, how do you want to use me? I surrender all. I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Savior. God is waiting for our surrender. Standing up all over. three more people in here who need to understand he's been blessed to be a blessing. You need to understand that. You need to grasp that right now. And God is saying, come on down. I need to change your life. There's three more. He's been waiting. Come on. He brought you to church this Sunday for this. In the name of Jesus. There's one more coming. There's one more who needs to come. One more who needs to come.
Today, we declare today.
Lord God, we just bless you. We believe by faith, Lord God, that you are more than able. We bind Satan, who is a liar, who will try to tell you that nothing happened on this day. Oh, but I just want you to know in the name and the power that is in the name of Jesus Christ, that if you believe by faith, hallelujah, you will be able to feel the change and see the change. And I declare you will be able to hear the change when you come to Jesus. So Lord God, we bless you, praise you, magnify you, and glorify you. In the awesome name of Jesus the Christ, our Lord, our Savior, our Master, he who has been waiting for us. In the name of Jesus we pray. All those who believe and receive say amen.
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 Give the Lord a hand.
Afternoon, we're having Family Day at 3:30. Please join us. Have a blessed day.